Our opening words this morning come from my colleague, Barbara Peskin. For the beauty of the earth, this spinning blue-green ball, yes. Yes. Gaia, mother of everything, we walk gently across your back to come together again. In this place, to remember how we can live, to remember who we are, to create how we will be together. Gaia, our home, the lap in which we live, welcome us today. Will you give voice to our chalice lighting words as they appear on the screen above? We kindle this flame to remind ourselves of the light of truth, the warmth of community, and the fire of commitment.
Good morning. Welcome to worship at the First Unitarian Universalist Society of Burlington. Today is Sunday, October 22nd, 2023. I'm Jeff Duke, a member of the Worship Associates team, and I'm very glad to be a part of today's service with Guest Minister Reverend Peter Newport, members of the Climate Change Response Team, and all the many hands that make this service possible. As a Unitarian Universalist faith community rooted in the heart of Burlington, we warmly welcome all people to the shared work of building beloved community and making meaning in our lives. This religious community is guided not by a creed, but by a commitment to each other and to a set of values that include love, compassion, service, truth, justice. As part of that commitment to truth and justice, we acknowledge that our UU meeting house and our homes, our schools, our places of work are built on the traditional lands of the Western Abenaki people who live here still. We give thanks for the opportunity to share in this place, to protect it, and to care for all those who call this place home. Autumn is here. In Underhill, where I live, the woods seem to glow with leaves of gold and yellow and orange, which contrast sharply with the dark umber lines of trunk and branch and the dark green of the nearby conifers. The pines have shed last season's needles, and the trails are covered with their soft, sticky bundles. Blue jays and squirrels and chipmunks are busy caching food for the long winter. And some nights ago, we heard the curious, amorous calls of porcupines. Autumn is here, and winter is coming. If you'd like to follow along with the order of service, you can scan the QR code in the inside cover of the gray hymnal if you're here today. If you're visiting with the live stream, you can also go to our website, uusociety.org, and click on the green button that says Live Stream Service. There you'll find the order of service as well as a button labeled New to Our Community. If you are new to our community and you feel comfortable, would you be willing to raise your hand so we can extend a special welcome to you? Welcome. Good morning. Welcome. Also, please join me in welcoming a group of young guests from Middlebury who are visiting our society this morning. Welcome. And if you're here in the meeting house today in person, there is there's an information card that you can fill out kind of the old-fashioned way with pen. And when it comes time, you can drop it in one of the offering baskets. Thank you, Marilyn. We also have designated welcome ambassadors who are here to answer any questions you might have about our worship service, our society, or Unitarian Universalism. Kim and Doug Watkin are standing in the back if you want to pick them out. Of course, we are all welcome ambassadors, and if you have any questions, any of us would be glad to talk with you about our society. Just a very quick reminder, we are aiming for 70 minutes of our service. I hear laughing. Yes. We're aiming. We'll see where it ends up. Of course, everyone is invited to join the coffee hour downstairs in the community room after the service, which you can reach by stairs or elevators through this door. It's a great time to meet new friends and learn more about our society and about the many things going on here at First UU. On your way to coffee hour, or perhaps afterwards, you might be interested in viewing some of the new paintings in the art gallery on the second floor. Again, this way to the stairs up or the elevator. After the service at 11:30, the Climate Justice Team is sponsoring a presentation today in the Whitney Young Jr. Room that's upstairs right in the middle of the art gallery. And the presentation is on a proposed expansion of the McNeil Generating Station to pipe steam heat to UVM Medical Center. The Climate Justice Team believes UVM Medical Center should prioritize our health and climate. Please join the team to learn more about this issue and how you can take action. Friends, whatever it took you to get here, wherever you've come from, wherever you are, whatever burdens and joys you are carrying, you belong. Your whole self is welcome here. Come, let us worship together.
Good morning. Invite you to stand with me in body or spirit as we sing together hymn number 123, hymn 123, Spirit of Life, and we'll sing it through a few times. Spirit of life, how much to be, sing in my heart, all the stirrings of passion, blow in the wind, rise in the sea, move in the land, giving life. Just our voices. Thank you for lending your voice. You may be seated.
And that includes all of you who are going to classes, so even you middle schoolers, because then you'll be ready to head out the door when the time comes. Right over here. Come on all the way down. Let's make space for everyone right over here. Do I have an assistant who would like to hold this here for me? Ophelia, did you want it? Oh, no, you're busy? Collins, come on up. All right, can you get your body behind it so that people here can see it? So I found this in my office, and hopefully you can sort of see it on the screen up here, maybe? No, it's coming out kind of white. Here, show it to the people here. Well, this is a picture, and it was drawn by somebody called Lorinda A. Henry in 1993. Anybody know Lorinda? Oh, yeah, some people know Lorinda. And it's beautiful, and at the bottom there are some words. Actually, first, let's see. It's a picture of this building, but it's a little special because it's got roots and branches and leaves just like a tree, right? So, Collins, can you actually show it to people? There we go. And it has some special words at the bottom, and the words say, "I will be a tree that you can come home to." And those words are by Margaret Wise Brown. Why do you think the person, Lorinda, who made this poster, chose to make the meeting house look like a tree? Any ideas? Charlotte?
Because trees are forgiving and they make people feel comfort.
Trees give people comfort? That's a good reason. Any other thoughts? What do you think, Fran?
It's because
they're homes for animals. They're homes for animals, so makes a good home for us too, right? Yeah, well, another reason might be that trees grow and change, right? Trees are alive, yeah? Our UU faith tradition is also alive. We say it's a living tradition. That means that it can change. Its roots might grow a little deeper. Its branches might reach a little higher, but it's still going to be the tree that we can come home to, right? And this building here is sort of the same way. This building has been here housing our congregation for more than 200 years, and it's changed. It's grown, actually, in that time. In fact, through this door, when I was a kid, that was outside. Yeah, all of that was not there forever and ever. But it might seem like it to us now, right? Have you been upstairs to the Susan B. Anthony room where the youth group meets? Anybody?
No.
Ever been up there? Some of you have. Yeah, how about downstairs? There's a room called the Reeb room that has some couches.
Yeah,
you've been there. Have you been on the back stairwell? Stairs back over there?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? Yeah, all of that is new. It wasn't always here. This building didn't always have an elevator. In fact, when this building was built, elevators had not been invented yet.
I know.
Now, when there was no elevator there, do you think it was very fair to the people who have trouble on stairs, getting up and down stairs? And before we had a ramp out here, do you think that felt very fair to people who need to use walkers or sit in wheelchairs? It probably didn't feel very fair. So buildings change, and sometimes we need to change them to make it more fair, right? Sometimes we need to change a building because we need more space to do all the things we like to do in it. And sometimes things get broken, or maybe they were never made right in the first place. Yes, Collins?
Sometimes the building needs new electric things, like elevators.
Yeah, sometimes we need elevators, right? So when we head downstairs with our groups, or upstairs for the middle school, to have our group explorations, everyone who's left in this room is going to do some talking about changes, repairs, things that need to happen in this building now. Because for one thing, up in the roof there's a whole big spot where there's no insulation. Does anyone know why insulation is important?
It keeps you warm.
It keeps you warm. It keeps the heat in, right? And so if there's no insulation, we use a whole bunch of energy that we otherwise wouldn't need to use. Is it fair to people in the future if we use a whole bunch of energy now that we don't need to use if it's going to hurt the earth later on?
No.
And who are the people in the future going to be?
Us.
Yeah, you guys. Not so fair. So we need some insulation, and I'm sure everyone here is going to have a fun time talking about that once we're gone. It's one more change that this building needs to make so that it can be the home that we will always return to. Thanks for listening. Let's sing the children out. Can you take lead, Ron?
Will you please repeat after me? As you journey, may you know, love and hope go with you. Learn and grow. All together. As you journey,
I think everything we needed to know we learned in kindergarten, right? And how to be nice to one another and how to take care of our people. So this next reading I'd like you to help me with, it's 444 in the hymnal. Perhaps it's being projected. It's called This House. And listen to these words because they have a lot of meaning for me. I think they will for you as well. I'll read the first words, and then you can read the italicized ones. I guess those are not italicized, but anyhow. All right, good. Got that clarified. All right, this house is for the ingathering of nature and human nature. It is a house of friendship, pain, and trouble, and open room. It is a house of freedom, guarding the dignity and the worth of every person. It is a house of truth seeking, where scientists can encourage devotion to their quest, where mystics can abide in a community of searchers.
It is a house of art, adorning celebrations, melodies, and handiworks.
It is a house of prophecy, outrunning times past and times present in visions of growth and progress.
This house is a
cradle for our dreams, the workshop of our common endeavor. Thank you.
And as the choir is getting into place, wanted to share with you just a little taste of what happened in this space, in this building, last night. We had about 125 singers celebrating the Solaris Vocal Ensemble's 10th anniversary, and this place was filled with people here and in the balconies all singing together. And so we were going to share with you one of the songs that we sung. It was our closer of the first half, and it's called, well, it's a little different words for May the Circle Be Unbroken. And Lance is going to help us get it started.
Good morning. We are in for a treat. You all are in for a treat. I want you to notice We have Sam and James on the piano this morning, and they're about to play the fun and joy off of that piano, and I don't know what that means, but it's going to be a lot of fun. So I'm going to invite you to help. We need to help them prepare for what's about to happen. So James, if you could give me the beat, please. Okay, so I'm going to ask you to snap your fingers with me. There you go. I'm going to ask you to sway a little bit, maybe move your body a little bit. There you go. Nice. I'm going to ask you to smile. Yeah, I know it's been 2 days of rain, and okay, I see some smiles out there. And that's that C. It goes, well, am I on it, James? Well, all right, here we go. Well, I was standing at the window on a dark and starry night. When I saw the sun come rising, bringing us a brand new light. You got it. Here we go.
May the circle
be unbroken.
Good morning. I'm John Lincoln. And?
I'm Bruce Douglas.
We are some members of the Society's Climate Change Response Team, and we hope you'll take away some good information from this service. Our faith calls on us to take ownership of the fact that our greenhouse gas emissions contribute to climate change. The good news is we collectively can practice what we preach. The good news, we can do this. We have begun the process of weaning ourselves for buildings from the fossil fuels. To do this, we will share both a very relevant part of the history of this church and the ongoing story of a small group of UU Society members who have been working on towards a carbon-based, fuel-free future.
So climate change has been documented to be caused by human activities, including burning carbon-based fuels such as wood, coal, oil, and gas, which release greenhouse gases to the atmosphere and cause a blanket of insulation that retains the sun's heat, generally warming the planet and shifting weather patterns. In the future, some places will be hotter, some will be wetter, some will be drier, some will be even colder as climate patterns shift and ocean and air currents change around the globe. This morning, we want to look back at our history, look at the present, and look forward. John, how do we measure climate change?
Greenhouse gases are generally measured as carbon dioxide equivalents. So you hear people referring to net zero carbon or zero carbon. Net zero carbon means that we're producing enough energy without burning carbon that offsets the equivalent amount of carbon that we are using. We are aiming to go beyond net zero and eliminate the use of current fuels in our building. The transition to zero carbon is called carbon decarbonization and will ensure us to make a positive impact in reducing our contribution to climate change.
To get there will be a long road. We need to start with reducing the amount of energy the building needs while maintaining indoor air quality year-round. Therefore, we need to tighten up the building envelope, the windows, the walls, the ceilings, the doors, insulating, air sealing, and all the while improving ventilation. You know, John, is a very relevant aspect of our church's history that pertains to climate change. This building was born in a time of extreme climate change. How did that happen?
Well, today we're in the original meeting house, which extends from the steps to this wall behind me. The year of 1815, the National Park Service publication about the eruption of Mount Tabor in Indonesia in 1815 triggered a change in global climate. Quote, the cloud blocked the sunlight from reaching the earth and changing the climate by 2 to 7 degrees Fahrenheit, the effects of which devastated much of the world in what would have been the summer of 1816. Crops failed across Europe and the US, and due to the cold or lack of sunshine, caused grain and oat prices to soar.
It is thought that that is the reason that our meeting house, from the foundation to the steeple, was completed in only 8 months. It's likely that it was the many farmers, craftspeople, and laborers who could provide the skills and labor for this building's rapid construction. It's an interesting fact that the original meeting house was heated by 2 wood stoves in the sanctuary, and there was a record of they were paying in the 1820s $1.50 a cord for firewood, and this room was lit by oil lamps.
Let's fast forward almost 200 years to 2006, when David McPheeters and I and others worked with Burlington Electric and attached energy monitoring devices on all major appliances and reviewed monthly electric bills to prioritize efforts with following steps forward. We placed lamps with LEDs. We added new motion sensors to some of the lighting so the light would be off when it's not needed. And we replaced an old refrigerator with an energy efficient model, reprogrammed the coffee maker, and adjusted heating zones, and replaced an old refrigerator, and installed energy efficient controls on heat and circulating pumps. It all adds up.
Right, and between 2006, 2011, David McPheeters and you, John, further reduce natural gas usage by changing the thermostat to a network system so the rooms could be programmed to have heat based on event schedules. Meanwhile, Chip Petullo, who we'll talk later, worked on a massive amount of insulation and air sealing, including the replacement of 32 leaky storm windows. They installed low emissivity storm windows that improves the performance better than double glazing. And they also insulated the attics of buildings at 34 Elmwood and 27 Clark Street.
By 2011, we had reduced electricity usage by 50% and gas usage by over 20%. In 2013, thanks to a generous donor, our very own photovoltaic panels were installed to collect solar energy and convert it to electricity. They have been providing shade to our cars in the summer and producing 100% of the annual electrical needs for this building. Yeah. We have installed air sealing to the main building, and there's other steps we can go before we go to carbon neutral carbon heating systems. Ideally, we want to cut the energy losses as much as possible and right size new heating systems appropriately. We will share more after the spiritual practices.
Thank you.
Thank you, John and Bruce. Spiritual practices come in many forms within our Sunday service. Generosity, spoken word, stillness, music, meditation. Creating space for our joys, for our sorrows, and for our gratitude. In this portion of our Sunday service, each of us will have the chance to enter into those communal practices to which we are drawn, to hold space and to offer our loving witness for each other. As a justice-seeking spiritual community, our generosity practice includes sharing half of the offering each Sunday. Offerings this month will be shared with the Association of Africans Living in Vermont, AALV, which helps new Americans from all parts of the world gain independence in their new communities through a range of integration services, including bridging case management, workforce development, behavioral health awareness, and interpreter services programming. With support from multicultural, multilingual staff, clients are able to smoothly transition to living and working in Vermont. When the music plays in just a moment, we invite you to come forward to silently mark a joy, a sorrow, or a gratitude in your life by moving a stone from one of the baskets onto the table, creating a representation of our shared lives in this particular fleeting moment. As you are moved, please come forward along the outside aisles and return to your seat via the central aisle. If you have a gift to add to the offering, you can place it in one of the baskets on your way up. If you are at home, or if you want to remain seating, we invite you to lean into the music as an opportunity for stillness and centering as it makes sense to you. This has been a difficult couple of weeks. Before we hear the joys and sorrows and gratitudes of this community, I want to share some words from civil rights activist Valerie Kaur. Valerie Kaur, author of See No Stranger. She writes, "Our most powerful response to the horror in Israel and Palestine is to refuse to surrender our humanity. You will be told by some, the deaths of Israeli children are unfortunate but inevitable because Israel's occupation of Palestine is brutal and wrong. You will be told by others, the deaths of Palestinian children are unfortunate but inevitable because it is the only way to keep Israel safe from terror, and Hamas brought this on its own people. Both will say, our aggression is the only response to their aggression, our fear more justified than their fear, our grief more devastating than theirs will ever be. But oh, my love, the hierarchy of pain is the old way. The moment we allow our hearts to go numb is the moment we shut down our humanity. She continues, I don't know the solution to the conflict in Israel and Palestine, but I do know the starting point, to grieve their children as our children. It's the only way to break the cycle. Now, let us deepen together into a time of quiet and connection. We will begin by sharing the joys, sorrows, and gratitudes of the community, and then hold a moment of stillness. Let us begin with four deep breaths. One breath for the solid earth beneath us. One breath for the changing sky above us. One breath for the living waters all around us. And one breath for the sacred fire within us. Come now into the place of peace and holy listening. Let us hear these words of joy, sorrow, and gratitude for this day, Sunday, October 22nd, 2023. Sorrow for the loss of my Aunt Marilyn, who loved her family and was very active in her community, living to help others. Our hearts are broken at the ongoing struggles of Gaza. Gratitude for all the help we received from this community while our child was missing on Wednesday. It meant so much to have so many people, especially an OWL student and parent and our amazing UU staff, looking out for him. He was found safe and is getting the help he needs. Heartbreak at the death of 6-year-old Palestinian-American boy, Wadia Al-Fayoumi, killed in an act of hate. May we hold the joys, the sorrows, and gratitudes of our community in a spirit of love, reminding us of our shared humanity. As we enter this moment of stillness, let us hold that which has been spoken and that which remains unspoken gently in our hearts. Thank you, Sam. Will you join me in the words to dedicate our offering? With gratitude, we dedicate these gifts in the service of our mission to inspire spiritual growth, care for each other and our community, seek truth, and act for justice. Blessed be.
Good morning. I'm Chip Patello.
And I'm Brian Haas.
The Climate Change Response Team was convened via an email from David McPheeters in October 2019 with the subject line, The Next 100 Years. At our first meeting, David shared his vision of eliminating the burning of fossil fuels on this campus, and the strategy of working to achieve that vision was embraced by the team. We do want to give a shout out to Mike Pelletier, who's a very active member of our team. He's out of town today. So, what have we been doing since then?
I'm going to add a parenthetical comment. David McPheeters and his wife, Susie, were in town just this last weekend and successfully sold their home and are now living in a wonderful community in southern New York. So they are well, and we're eternally grateful to David, especially for his work. So from 2019 to 2022, the Climate Change Response Team has been working with Burlington Electric, Vermont Gas, and our energy consultant, which is CX Associates, to develop a path forward towards a zero carbon campus and beyond. CX Associates has analyzed our energy bills and the building's current envelopes, and has concluded that the next step in the path forward is to further reduce the energy demands of all the buildings on this campus. It's this building plus the other three buildings that are on this campus. As mentioned earlier, it's critical to tighten up the building envelopes so that we have the least amount of energy demand when we analyze alternatives for kicking our carbon fuel habit.
To embark on our next step, we wrote the following letter presented to the First Unitarian Universalist Society of Burlington, the Board of Trustees, this past spring. To quote from that letter, we were making a concrete proposal to the board for the next phase of our work, funding the consulting services to develop bid documents to significantly enhance the energy efficiency of the meeting house. Our audacious ideal would be to completely eliminate the use of fuels that contribute to local and global climate change, essentially decarbonizing FUUSB's building stock.
So the letter went on to say, the response team has been working towards energy efficiency in a practical step-by-step manner with the help of local utilities and an energy consultant. The climate response team has analyzed energy usage and has confirmed that heating and ventilating and air conditioning, also known as HVAC, are the largest areas of energy consumption for the four buildings. Improving air sealing, insulation, and ventilation are the largest opportunities for improving energy efficiency and will enable appropriate sizing of future heating and ventilating systems.
Our statement finishes by saying how the current project fits our long-term goals. To quote, once the building envelope improvements are done, we will be able to measure the effectiveness of the improvements and more reliably compare alternative measures to accomplish the full decarbonization project, and then develop a budget and timeline for that work that will require more grants and fundraising.
The good news is that the board has already approved modest funds required to engage our energy consultant to prepare bid documents. And these bidding documents would then be used to obtain contractors to better seal the building envelope and improve insulation of the buildings and enhance the meeting house's ventilation system.
We are not alone in this effort. On a national and ecumenical level, Interfaith Power and Light has been working with congregations around the country in taking bold action on climate change. On the state level, Vermont Interfaith Power and Light carries on that mission in 87 Vermont communities, congregations. Within our denomination, the UUA's Green Sanctuary Movement been active since 1989 and has developed an in-depth roadmap of actions for congregations seeking to start or deepen their climate justice work. These organizations all have focused on climate change with explicit actions toward mitigating and adapting to climate change.
So you may ask, what can I do to get involved and what can we do together? We would be remiss if we were not mentioning the fact that this society has the climate justice team, different from the climate action response team. But the climate justice team is providing a presentation, as was mentioned earlier, this morning at 11:30. We hope you'll participate in that. You can also keep an eye on for announcements about that will let you know how you can help with the climate change response team, the work that this group is talking about, to continue to implement our initiatives. We generally meet monthly, and the next few months, we will be planning a broader meeting to involve all of you and refine the scope of the air sealing, insulation, and ventilation projects.
Our meetings are always open, so if this is a topic that speaks to you, the response team has a place for you. For all of you here and at home, we encourage you to look at your own energy use and look for ways to reduce your own carbon emissions. You can seek out and act on ways that you can address climate change in your community.
We are a congregation that has a meeting house that is constructed during a major climate change event in 1816 that was mentioned earlier, during the year with no summer. And we have the opportunity to make this meeting house itself a significant beacon, leading the way to how to respond to the current changing climate and with a net zero carbon budget and ultimately a carbon fuel free future. Working together with loving hearts and focused minds, may it be so.
Thank you to everyone who shared today. I invite you to stand with me in body or spirit as we begin our closing hymn together. It's in the teal hymnal, if you would like to grab that. It's 1017 in there, Building a New Way. But I'm going to need your help to get us started like this. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. We are building a new way. We are building a new way. We are building a new way, feeling stronger every day. We are working to be free. We are working to be free. We are working to be free. With pride and jealousy, we are working to be free. Let's switch to a hand clap, shall we? We can feed our every need. We can feed our every need. We can feed our every need. Start with love, that is the seed. Every need, peace and freedom. Peace and freedom is our cry. Peace and freedom. crown. Can we do We Are Building one more time?
We are building a new way.
You don't need the words. Sing with me.
We are building.
Thank you all so much. Please be seated.
Will you give voice to our chalice lighting, distinguishing words? We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts and share with the world until we are together again. Our closing words this morning are a mashup of words of our two universalist prophets, John Murray and Hosea Ballou. And they go really well together, and they're in the back of the hymn book, they're right on top of each other, so I'm gonna do them both. Here we go. If we agree in love, there is no disagreement that can do us any injury. But if we do not, no other agreement can do us any good. Let us endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace. Go out then into the highways and byways. Give the people something of your new vision. You may possess but a small light, but uncover it. Let it shine. Use it in order to bring more light and understanding to the hearts and minds of men and women. Give them not hell, but hope and courage. Preach the kindness and everlasting love of God. May it be so. Go in peace and blessed be.